Facilities that make this program possible are provided by the City of Highland Park. Programs are produced independently by members of the community. The City of Highland Park is not affiliated with the following program or the producers of public access programming and is not responsible for the content. The following program does not reflect the opinions of the City of Highland Park.
Joyce. I'm a member of the Highland Park Senior Producers, and today our guest is Sandra Charak, and she's a rabbinical student and a meditator.
Meditator,
and she's going to talk to you all about healing, and we're so glad to have her today, and welcome, Sandra.
Thank you so much, Joyce. I'm so grateful that you are having me on today, that I get to share my passion with people.
De nada. Okay, we're glad to have you because this is something different for us, and it's, your views, but it's very interesting and helpful, too. So, what made you get into this, to go to rabbinical school and to be interested in healing and feng shui, okay, and Kabbalah, and you want to tell us all about it?
Thank you. Well, I started meditating when I was in college, and that had a lot to do with the fact that I had dyslexia and central auditory processing disorder, and it really helped me with focus and getting through University of Illinois. And
downstate, was it?
Yes, It was downstate. And I graduated with an economics degree concentrating in international economics, which is quite a turn, but I studied about corporations and health, and I got interested in feng shui because I realized that in different places we would feel more comfortable than in other places, It's really the energies. But meditation kind of opened up my whole universe by expanding what I would believe could happen to people and how we can control things. But about 10 or 12 years ago, I met Rabbi Dr. Douglas Goldhammer. And he is a healing, meditating, Kabbalistic rabbi. And so
he's located in Skokie?
Yes, in Skokie. And he taught me much more about meditation and how we can access the greater world through meditation. And that's really by bringing down God, or what in Kabbalah, the primordial God was called the Ein Sof, which actually means without end. So, and the Ein Sof created, according to Kabbalah, created the world. So we could call him by his names, his multitude of names, no matter if you want to call it the God of nature, the God of Hashem or Jesus, Allah, what the spirit, what the Indians called was the spirit. So it doesn't matter what we call him. The goal with meditation is to bring and uplift God in us and bring us into balance. And when we can bring ourselves into balance, we can bring ourselves into an easier state of healing. And so that's what meditation, the goal is, but there's different types of meditation.
Three, did you say?
Yeah, there's about three different types. There's guided meditations, which most people have tried. It would be, close your eyes, envision yourself walking along the beach, feel the sand between your toes, feel the beautiful sun on your skin. Imagine how that feels. Hear the waves. And that's a guided meditation. Mm-hmm. Another type of meditation is a mantra meditation, would be repeating something over and over. And one mantra meditation.
Do you repeat it out loud or silently?
Silently, oh. Usually. And one that I love is really kind of can calm your whole nervous system, mm-hmm. is just doing some easy belly breathing and mm-hmm. saying, I love God and God loves me, as you inhale and exhale. And that will, it's been shown where it will lower your blood pressure mm-hmm. and calm your whole nervous system.
Oh, uh-huh. I would never know that you had had problems before you went into all this, because you seem so even-keeled, is that the word? I'm not going to say normal. I don't know if there is such a thing as normal, but no.
I don't think so.
No. Anyway, like you don't even care in the world or something, but you're into all this. This is why, I guess.
Yes. It makes... You lived life differently when you can meditate and you can be in balance. Mm-hmm. You try not to let all of the outside influences attack you then.
Yeah.
And then you can lead your life with your heart and kindness. It's mm-hmm. almost like what today so much is mindful meditation. Have you heard that term?
I don't know if I have. I'm not going to say for sure.
It's very popularized today.
Oh.
And that is trying to live in the moment and know that a lot of things aren't, it isn't about you. Not everything in the world is always about you, what's
mm-hmm.
happening.
Mm-hmm.
Because people are all into their own lives. Mm-hmm. And if somebody might brush you or hit you by mistake, it's not necessarily, they might not have even noticed.
Yeah, sometimes like in movies, they get angry and they fight the other person or shoot them or something, like they think it's on purpose or something.
And it's really not.
No, everything isn't about you. Like, people should know that. Like, everybody's not thinking about everybody else, I mean.
Mm-hmm. And so when you're trying to live within the mindful meditation, you try to be more aware mm-hmm. of what you're doing and how you're affecting other people and how mm-hmm. other people are affecting you.
Oh.
But when you bring yourself into balance through bringing in and opening up God in you, you end up, if you have an illness, it will help the doctors heal you better.
Oh.
Because you're open more to the healing.
Mm-hmm. I see. Uh-huh. And doctors agree with this, some of the doctors?
Yes. In fact, there's a lot of studies now going on in the universities, Harvard and Cambridge. Duke Medical has uh-huh. a whole department on spirituality and healing.
So and it can all be documented, too, correct?
Right. Yes. And I've got a lot of abstracts that if anybody would like to see copies of the abstracts, if they email me at sandrameditates@gmail.com. I'd be happy to send anybody copies of the abstracts, and they can do their own research into how meditation, they've been saying, will help you calm your nervous system. It can help lower your blood pressure. It can aid with heart health. And they're also talking about how it can aid with brain function.
Oh.
They're doing a lot of studies with MRIs now while people are meditating and
oh.
seeing how much of the brain, there's more of the brain functions. It lights up during the MRI. I'm not a doctor, so I'm not exactly uh-huh. sure how, and I can't understand completely all the studies because I don't understand all the
That's
terminology.
That's a good place to meditate when you're having an MRI.
Yes.
Yeah.
Because it's kind of nerve-wracking.
I know, I just keep my eyes closed, but then they ask you questions like, are you all right? You know, things like
mm-hmm.
that. Uh-huh. But it's not painful at all.
Right, but if you tell them that you're going to meditate and try and go somewhere else during the MRI process and to not ask you questions, then maybe they would not.
Oh, that's true. That's true. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, as long as you tell them that your plan is to...
Then, like, sometimes I have claustrophobia, but that doesn't bother me for some strange reason. And, I don't like to be closed in, like...
So then what you probably do is you go into a state where you're relaxing and breathing, and you close your eyes. It's a you can say you're really going into a meditative state when you're doing that.
Yeah, really.
Because you're just breathing calmly and trying to relax yourself.
And then the noise, they give you something for your ears, I know. When the inside is white, it's better than if it's black, I think, because in black is just so much darkness, you know.
And then if you open your eyes, you're kind of like, where am I?
Yeah, right. Did I die?
Oh, no, no.
And what about dreams?
Dreams can tell you things, but you have to ask questions about everything.
Oh, who do you ask, God? Or?
You ask yourself when you're in a meditation.
Oh.
And it's just like you can ask different parts of your body how it's feeling. And when you in yoga, sometimes when they talk about relaxing from the head to toe, ask your head how you're feeling and how is it feeling today. And tell the body parts that you love your different body parts. It's just talking to yourself and telling yourself that you matter. And that your body and your heart matters to your head.
Yeah. Oh, yesterday I was reaching up in the kitchen in the cabinets, and I had squeezed stuff in there, and the top of a big pan, it was like metal, it fell and hit me here. Did that hurt? But I don't have a lump or anything. It's strange.
Well, that was kind of nice that you didn't have a lump or anything.
Because last year I fell on the street once because there was a hole in the street. I had to be taken to the hospital by ambulance and it was black and blue. But they say it's better to fall forward because it could kill you.
Well, if you hit the back of your head, it's really bad.
Yeah, I never knew that until recently. But anyway, yeah, so that pan, did that hurt?
Yeah.
I put cold on it, I don't know.
Well, but you didn't get a black and blue mark.
No,
so
and I didn't get a lump or anything.
What did you do afterwards? Did you sit down and try and calm yourself down and breathe into maybe the pain?
No, I went and got some cold water and held it on there.
Right.
And in about 10 minutes it went away. But then I put the thing back up there. I made it tighter. It was a big lid.
Let's hope it doesn't happen again.
Yeah, okay. I don't even cook. I don't know what I have it for. But
so with meditating, you said you've tried it?
Yeah, because I used to take Qigong and Tai Chi and different Eastern, what do you call them? Not exercises.
Well, they're Eastern philosophies, just like feng shui is an Eastern philosophy that deals with energies in a household and where to place furniture pathways to use and colors. And really with feng shui, here's a little trick. Fire and water are your two most powerful elements. And if you want to know if your fireplace is a good thing to burn, don't do much on anything for a couple of weeks beforehand. Burn your fireplace and then journal about it. And there's only one of three outcomes. Either it's neutral, either after you've burnt your fireplace, it will bring you gifts, or the third is that it's not so good to burn and you might find that you have a problem or two that acquires. And that can kind of show you how energies in this world might affect you that we don't see.
Oh, yeah.
And that's the same thing with when you are meditating and you're working with Kabbalah and healing prayer, is how you bring the energies in that you might not realize that they're affecting you because you don't see them. But that little hint with feng shui, with your fireplace, because there's only three outcomes, if you try and meditate and you start bringing in and really enlightening the higher power in this world, in your own body, then you start seeing things in a different way and maybe leading your life more with kindness. Which this world, in my opinion, can certainly use, everybody leading more with kindness and love.
Right, right.
Because we all are in a community.
Yes.
Connected. To one another.
Like, we're all relatives of David, someone said.
Well, we're all, you know, that whole thing about 6 degrees of separation that you can always find. Well, we are all really connected because we all come from the same source. And if we all have what I would call God in us, everybody, every person in this whole world, it doesn't matter what your color is, your religion, where you're from, that means we're all connected.
Right, right.
And we're energy.
Yes.
And if we're all energy and God's energy, that if we try to, if we meditate and we can bring balance to ourselves, we'll help bring more balance to the world.
Oh, and when did God, I mean, when did we start having God, you know?
Well, I think God created the whole world and the whole universe. So when I said the Ein Sof, which means without end in Hebrew, then we're all part and parcel. God created the whole universe, as according to Kabbalah, is to be called by his names, and it doesn't matter what name. So we're all connected, and we can help heal ourselves by bringing God into this world.
Oh, what about atheists or agnostics?
Well, agnostics aren't sure, and atheists don't believe in any higher power. But they believe, whatever they believe in, if they're kind, it doesn't matter. We have to really bring kindness.
Oh, I see. Mitzvahs.
Mitzvahs, random acts of kindness.
If anybody knows what that is.
Right, random acts of kindness of helping people.
Yeah, and you're not just a brag. I did a mitzvah.
Right, but I'm happy to teach anybody how to meditate.
See, I did take those classes, but then they told me how many minutes or hours or whatever I had to meditate at home, and I just didn't want to do that. I don't know. I have so much to do. I know that's more important, but I just stopped doing it.
Well, you can start with just a few minutes a day, and one of it is, as I was talking about belly breathing earlier. And
right,
that is one
I've been told about that in classes.
That's one of the first ways to learn to meditate. If you just can pick a mantra, any mantra that you love, and just do some belly breathing. And when situations get really tough, and I've worked with a lot of people on this, and when they start getting real nervous and tough, and when they're in a situation that they don't know how to handle, they kind of spend just a couple of minutes, maybe 90 seconds, just thinking about something and breathing easily with a short belly breathing. And all of a sudden, the tension melts away, and they can start thinking clearer on how to work through the situation.
Oh, does it make a difference if you're a mouth breather or or through the nose?
No.
Oh.
Whichever makes you more comfortable.
Oh, okay. It doesn't matter. Yeah. Because I know for certain tests, like medical tests sometimes, or when they cover your mouth and things and put you out and stuff, it makes a difference. So.
Right. No, but this is, it's going to be whatever makes you feel most comfortable.
I see.
Because we're talking about the individual person.
Yeah.
And how it works for them.
And what about energy? What were you going to say about energy?
We're all energy. We're made up of atoms and molecules and quarks and electrons. And they've proven, I didn't bring it with me, but there's a parlor trick that I do with a pendulum. You take a pendulum and you put it next to a curved surface, and it will spin one way.
Oh.
And if you put it next to a 90-degree angle. It will spin the opposite way. Oh. And really, anybody can take this and do this at home.
Oh.
And it shows how electrons, and really there's movement off of everything, even though we don't see it.
Oh, yeah. Uh-huh.
And our thoughts are very important, and what we say to ourselves. Mm-hmm. And there's this social scientist from Japan, Emoto, who created this book where he took pictures. He took water, and he would put different sayings on the outside of the water, and he would freeze it, uh-huh. and then took electron microscope pictures of the water. And when he had hateful sounds, the water crystals were really very unpleasant.
Really?
And when he had happiness or caring or kindness or love, mm-hmm. beautiful words on the outside, they created beautiful crystals out of this water.
Oh, interesting.
So
yeah.
It shows how our thoughts and what we say to ourselves really can change the way we behave and our own makeup.
Mm-hmm.
And again, that goes back to the meditating and bringing God in. If we believe that we are made out of light and kindness, we will act more as if we are made out of light and kind.
Oh.
And brings more balance to our bodies, and therefore easier for us to heal our bodies.
Do you feel like people are going the other way more, like without kindness and things?
No, I think there's a lot of people who are striving for kindness in this world. And I'm really very happy to see it. Yes, I do. I think there's lots of people. And it's just something that we have to increase.
But I believe
there's so many people who are working for the good in this world.
Oh. Uh-huh. Yeah, no matter what the religion, right?
Yes, uh-huh. It doesn't matter where they come from.
Uh-huh.
There's people in all walks of life that want goodness and kindness.
Mm-hmm. What about these people that go to other countries to help people? What are they called?
The missionaries?
Missionaries, that's a word.
On the whole, I think they want to really help people.
Oh.
And if they're bringing it out of love and trying to help, people go and they build water plants and teach people how to plant, and the big thing is showing women how to make money in different countries.
Really?
Yes, so they can better themselves.
But, and learning, I guess, going to learn something. Some people can't read or write,
Yes.
Right. Oh, by the way, you said if somebody wants to
get any of the abstracts.
Yeah, I just wanted to say there's no charge.
Yes, no. All they have to do is email me. I will be very happy to send them abstracts so they can do some more research on how much meditation and bringing the supernal being, God, into their lives can really help them heal themselves and help us heal the world.
Right.
And bring kindness and love into the world.
Oh.
And my mentor wrote a book. His name is, I said, Rabbi Dr. Douglas Goldhammer, Healing with God's Love and Hidden Kabbalah Secrets.
Yeah, if you want to hold it up.
And it's a wonderful book, and it will tell people how to start working on doing basic meditations to bring healing to their lives.
You would think that doctors wouldn't believe in it because it's against a lot of their ideas and teachings,
But I think, doctors want to see people get healed.
I don't know. There's several ways to look at it, what doctors want.
No, I think doctors are wonderful, and they really want to see people get well and healed. And I think they are...
Yeah, it's an accomplishment, really.
Yes, and there's the Cleveland Clinic has a whole section on functional medicine, which is alternative healing, and they do it also at Mayo. And I met the doctor from Mayo who is in charge of all of the alternatives, and he says it's the patients that want this.
Yeah.
That have brought about the new ways of healing and helping. But it's really it all works together. It's synergistic.
Oh. Is that at mainly at the Mayo in Rochester or any other?
Well, I think they're
one in Arizona, one in Florida, I know.
Well, I met the gentleman from Rochester. It was a number of years ago.
Oh.
But many of the doctors in the hospices are getting into this because they know
uh-huh.
that they need to have a partner in healing. And it's really, you're healing with the doctor as a partner.
Mm-hmm.
When you are ill
yeah.
and you have your family members that work with you that are going to do meditation and healing prayer with you,
yes.
you are in partnership
oh.
with the doctor.
I see.
So you're working with the doctor, and you're working with your own body and your own healing.
Yeah, I know of people they've done wonders for, but I didn't know that meditation was involved. It probably is.
It
yeah.
is, but that's what a lot of prayer is meditation.
Right, right. I know my mother was sick for 2 years on a ventilator, and I prayed it kept her alive, and she wasn't suffering. She knew I couldn't handle it without her till I was ready.
Mm-hmm.
So I know each time they said, this is it, and she had 9 lives, I'm sure.
And you were there, and you were praying, and you were praying with her.
And I lived in the ventilator hospital even with her
okay.
for 2 years.
So, but that's it. But you were doing that as a partnership with her doctors.
Yeah. And with God, mainly,
yes.
I would say.
That's exactly it, with God.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yes. Uh-huh. So you've even proven that it does work.
I know. I really think so, because they never expected her to be able to. And she'd talk and everything. Like,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. She knew what was going on, and somewhat. Uh-huh. And so I could, you know, mention that as where it worked. Mm-hmm. But in certain ways, you know, like the wounds got worse, things like that, but that's because of the people taking care. They're busy and they don't get to the people, but that's...
But that's bed sores, and also you weren't concentrating on healing that either. If
no.
you would have been maybe putting energy into that, it would
that's
have been less.
That's true, yeah, yeah. We're almost ready to wind down already. Can you believe this?
Wow.
I know, only a few more minutes left. And.
Well, I hope everyone, I want to thank everybody for spending their time and listening to this discussion.
Yeah, and you wholeheartedly believe in it so much. I mean, yeah, so
I'm sure
there's hundreds or thousands or millions of people that do also. So.
Yes, and I know it really works that you can help bring healing into your own life
mm-hmm.
and working in partnerships, but it's also wonderful when you have a prayer partner
right.
if you are sick to help pray with you.
Right.
Because sometimes it's difficult when you are in pain
mm-hmm.
to really reach the areas of meditation you have to. And when you have somebody taking in their love and bringing it into your body,
right.
that will help you as well.
And some people just don't understand. They tell you to pull the plug, you know, like, you know what the situation is and what
right.
it's best to do.
People have to make their decisions for themselves,
right.
and each
not
family.
Listen to everybody, yeah.
They're all very difficult and very personal decisions.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Like, I've met friends from that period. It was like 18 years ago or something. When
mm-hmm.
her insurance ran out, they stopped everything. So what does that tell you? I don't know. Anyway, so thank you so much for coming. And this was really so interesting. And I'll have to go further my studies. Thank you.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate this.
Uh-huh.
I'm very grateful.
Thank you. So keep it up. Keep up the good work. And tell people about it like you are. And it really struck the, I mean, I became more interested too now, and I'm gonna follow through and see. I,